Hey, what's going on, you Linux-loving miscreants? We're back for another week of weekly Daily Wednesdays in Binstone, joined every week by Jill Brent.
Hello, hello.
Live on Twitch. Hey, come pop in. Just say hi. Be like, hey, how's it going? Type in the chat and be like, hello, how are you doing, person watching us on Twitch? But we do have a big show for you this week. Jill, you what did you do, Jill? Did you walk too far?
Yeah, I don't know what I did, but I sprained my leg a bit yesterday, and it was quite painful. And I couldn't walk easily. And fortunately, today it is better. And I'm on medication right now. I didn't sprain it so bad that I couldn't walk, but it was painful nonetheless. And I couldn't even play Trackmania yesterday because it hurt to sit. It's not fun. Yeah. And so next week I will be on vacation just for 1 week, and we'll be back the following. So I'll miss everyone next week, and I don't know what Ven's going to do yet.
Neither does Ven. I just found out. So
yes, he just found out. So
stay tuned. There might be surprises, kids. Yes. What have I been playing around with? NDI, all the things, man. You know what an NDI is? If you want to send video over a network from one PC to another, it's something that you can do. It's completely free. Years and years ago, about like 4 years ago, I did a little guide for it. New Tech put it up on their blog. It got a lot of traffic. It's horribly out of date. One of the things I've been doing in the background is going back with Interfacing Linux and updating this stuff. And I'm like, man, that needs a rework. It has turned into its own project. Very fascinating. Also busting some myths about dual PC streaming setups and what you should and should not expect from it. Stay tuned for that. And I was very excited. I didn't get one, but I now have two new patrons. That was pretty wild. That
awesome.
Was pretty exciting. I was like, oh, look, I have patrons on Interfacing Linux. Neat. So I got some stuff coming for you lot. Thanks for that. YouTube channels, RushNet forum got crushed this morning because I posted a link about Harrison removing Linux support for their audio plugins. And I posted that on social medias, and that got a lot of traction at one time. You know you're getting traction when you start getting email alerts. You're like, servers having problems. I'm like, okay, we got that sorted, but it didn't go down. Good times. Now, let's go ahead and hop right into it. This week, stat counters, number digits, lies, and statistics. We love them.
Oh, it's very exciting for us here in the Linux world. And yeah, so Linux desktop usage is going up again. Woohoo! So in July 2024, it went up to 4.45% from June's 4.05%. And that's a pretty significant increase. And this is actually according to the StatCounter statistics website, you know, whose statistics keeps the Linux category separate from that of Google's Chrome OS. And interestingly enough, though, did you notice this, Ven? The Linux desktop usage is higher than Chrome OS's. that's pretty cool. I recall like a year ago seeing that. And of course, Linux was underneath Chrome OS, so it's nice to have it above. And, you know, Chrome OS, this is also something interesting, is actually listed at 1.41% for July, which went down from the previous months. And honestly, I think this is because the kids are on summer vacation and out of school because they're the primary users of Chromebooks. So that seemed to make sense, but I'm sure it's going to go up again after the school year starts. And I was finding out this information and looking through the charts, I was just thinking, you know, are we finally seeing a more accurate desktop usage of Linux? You know, considering it is hard to track all the downloads of Linux, with Linux Live USBs, flash drives, you know, being shared and sneaker netted from one person to the next, and, you know, web browser usage. And the like. So Linux has always been harder to track. So I really think these numbers are actually probably higher. But the fact that it reached 4.45% from these statistics is marvelous.
We got to pour one out for our FreeBSD users, though, at not 1%. Like that's where the real hardcore people run their desktops right there. FreeBSD. You got to love them. You do. You got to give them a little bit of respect, a little bit of love. But we're seeing that jump from last week. What was it? Back in July. I went and looked it up. Yeah, 4.45%. What's causing this? Well, I mean, we're still in rounding error territory, right? We got 7.14% unknown, 445 for Linux and 141 for Chrome. Yeah, I thought Chrome OS would be a bit higher too. So I do question how exactly they're tracking this. I'm just going to go ahead and say any increase in Linux is more like desktop users. I don't know. Like Steam Decks. There you go.
And you know what? That other category may be like our Internet of Things.
It could be IoT. It could be Raspberry Pis, like whatever.
Yeah. which run Linux mostly. So,
but who knows? I mean, it's good as the Windows is, you know, going to Windows 11 and Microsoft is doing very much Microsoft things with like locking it down and creating a very hostile desktop experience of, you know, this is how you do this thing this way and you do not get an option for it. People are going out and exploring other options and it takes a lot, you know. Fortunately, today in 2024, I used to always have the joke, you go down to the Linux store and you buy a Linux PC. And that's what you do. That's something that is actually a viable option. You know, long gone are the days of having to fight with Dell or whoever and pay a Windows tax for an operating system you're never going to use. And if you're at home, it doesn't cost you anything other than just a little bit of curiosity. So throw it down. Give it a try. Linux doesn't bite, usually. Yes. Now, we all love Google. Everybody loves Google. Google's that little indie startup, scrappy young bunch out there making that new web browser a couple of people have heard of, but there was a ruling this week. There was. So if you don't know, Google pays to be the default search engine on mobile browsers. And, you know, just desktop browsers, you see it in Firefox and the Department of Justice. Oh, yeah. They ruled that it has done that very illegally. They've used it to maintain a monopoly. Which I don't know how I want to weigh in on that, because right or wrong, this could end up with Google tapping the brakes on shipping dump trucks of money to Apple, which I don't think anybody is going to hurt Apple, but what it might hurt is that dump truck of money going to Mozilla.
Yeah.
This could be a problem. I've talked about this before, back in 2022, that Google check was over like 80% of Mozilla's revenue. And Mozilla's just playing it real cool right now. We're like, oh, we're exploring other things. I'm sure there's some panic at the disco on that side right there. And I don't know how this is going to play out, you know, because a lot of people have had some very valid complaints about Mozilla's leadership as of late. You know, we're like, hey, let's focus back on the browser. And they've just grown accustomed to that. And I understand, we've talked about it. That's why Google writes that check. They don't want monopoly things coming up and all this. And they're like, okay, so we no longer have, oh, so we are a monopoly. All right, fine. We don't have to spend that money anymore. Mm-hmm. If Firefox dies though, I don't think we need to worry about that though. Let's not even talk about that, because I don't think Google wants Firefox to die. I still think they're going to be invested in keeping another browser around to avoid take two of somebody coming after them for having the monopoly browser. And at the end of the day, Google's definitely going to appeal this, but you got to think about stuff like that, man, because you know, you want to get celebrated and like, yes, that's, and I've read several good arguments on the internet, surprisingly, about, you know, Google pays to be, one of the funny things to come out of this in the court cases, it turns out Microsoft tried to pay Apple to be the default search, and Apple's like, you cannot pay us enough money to make you the default search for Bing. It'll never happen. There's no amount of money that'll, and I think like a lot of people, you know, you switch, we have options on Firefox, Chrome, a little drop-down menu of Aldi, Brave, whatever you want to use. This might be a bit of a wake-up call to like all this other stuff, but it does make you step back and hopefully some of you see through a different lens why Mozilla has been trying all this weird stuff, man.
Mm-hmm.
Just weird stuff. I mean, it looks like you're going to stick with the browser. Mozilla's like, we definitely need alternate revenue streams and we got to try to find something. So there we go. What are your thoughts on this, Jill?
Oh boy. So when this landed yesterday about the Google monopoly ruling, you know, my first thought was, what about Mozilla? And Ven found a perfect article online about this very question, what about Mozilla? And Mozilla, you know, gets a lot of money from Google as Ven was saying, for using their search as the default. And I was thinking the DOJ must have missed how Google helps maintain smaller projects and their competition. So probably, you know, that wasn't even a thought, or they didn't look into it. And although, like, you know, Ven was talking about earlier, in the long run, the Chrome browser might be the next antitrust case. And, you know, let's hoping the Firefox web browser can survive, and that we're not looking at Netscape versus Internet Explorer all over again. This was really sad news, but I think Ven's right. I think Mozilla will survive, and our beloved Firefox open source web browser.
Yeah.
It'll be a long time down the road before we have to have a follow-up discussion on those. Plenty of time for Mozilla to get things figured out. Now, if you were around in the pre-show, I talked about Manjaro. And I was curious. Mm-hmm. Let me know in the comments. I want to get some feedback on this. Because, like, the last time I poked my head into that room of you crazy kids running Arch, there was the, I run Arch. And I run Manjaro, and the Archer was like, that's not really Arch. And I was talking to Art Theron before the show, and he's like, well, that's kind of toned down a little bit. And I was like, we now call that Arch on easy mode, basically. And I'm like, I understand the comparison. You know, I run Debian on everything in the studio. And if grew up just using Ubuntu and you switch over to Debian, you're going to be very confused. And if you grew up just using Debian and you switch to the Ubuntu, you're just going to be very mad. I wonder, does that still live in Archland? Let me know. Is everybody just copacetic these days? We're like, everything, it's great, just run it. But the reason I want to talk about Arch is because we need to talk about Manjaro the Immutable, which is now out for community testing. Yay. Also, do not install this right now as your main OS. Please, pretty please do not, or it will explode, knock down your back door, and run out screeching into the night. But Berlick dropped this into the show notes. That's something you could do if you're one of our beautiful patrons, and we'll take a look at it. And I'm like, yeah, I think that's something I want to talk about on Wednesday.
Yeah.
And he writes in, he's like, yo, Manjaro Immutable version debuts for the security and stability of a read-only package loadout with the sacrifice of rebooting to a new root FS with new packages. Yeah, that was kind of the thing I ran into with Silverblue. But this is an experimental release. The goal of Manjaro the Immutable is to build something which appeals to people who want stuff to just work. You don't have to think about it. You just put it in. It's great, because I'm just going to roll back any changes when and if something explodes. That's kind of the dream of it. And, you know, I definitely did a stream of Fedora Silverblue a couple of months ago. And that was my first experience with an immutable thing. And I'm like, this is pretty cool. It started up. We didn't have a problem with it. And I did a live stream here on Twitch.
Yeah.
And then we got to the thing of, like, and fortunately, I had some help. I had some people paying attention. And I went to install I forget what I was trying to install. And they're like, well, you got to do that. Now you got to restart the system. I'm like, nope, I'm out. I'm out. Not for me. Might be for you. Not for me. If I got to do a reboot after doing that, well, there's ways to work around. I'm like, no, but I could see something like this. Yeah, I think people have a more experience with, you know, immutable, semi-immutable type stuff. Again, let's bring back the Steam Deck, right? Because that's running Arch these days. Something for your desktop. Is this something you're interested in? Do you just want, like, a system you put together, it runs, and it's Arch, it's a rolling distro. Uh-oh, something broke. Make it real easy to just go, dial it back.
Yeah.
And you're like, hey, everything works again. And we'll just wait that out. Because I know having a broken system can be a real pain. But also having a broken system, you can learn a lot.
Hey, you learn a lot, yeah. It looks like Ven Artharan said in chat that he has the immutable Manjaro in a VM right now. And is just starting to play with it. So that's awesome. And I did that too, Artharan. So thank you for mentioning that. And, you know, because this is just really wonderful news. You know, I've been waiting for a pure Manjaro immutable distro to come out. I knew it was going to happen eventually, because there are several Arch-based ones like SteamOS and BlendOS. And so what was neat in this on the blog is the user Romang from the Manjaro team states, "Our plan is definitely for it to become an official variant of Manjaro. With the community testing version, we're now gathering some feedback on what people expect from such a variant and what should still go in there or what could be slimmed down." So there you have it. They really want this an official distro. And that's just awesome.
I think it's pretty wild. Go play with it. I've never, you know, outside of the olden times when it was, you know, the challenge to get Arch installed, and you're like,
yeah,
had to handwrite your XOR config, not XF86 and XOR config. Wait, no, it's XF86 was what it was. You know, I'm getting old, kids. Get off my lawn. Yeah. Old man Ben's having a senior moment here. Now it's XOR, which it's not even, you don't really need. And okay, that's not true.
Yeah.
I need an XOR config file. You probably don't at home. I do. Trust me on this.
You do.
Go play with it. There'll be a link in the show notes. You can probably just do a search for it. And let me know what you think of it. Like, is that something you're looking for? Do you want that? Do you want that type of system? Do you want, we have Chromebooks at home, but with more Arch. I think that might be neat.
Yeah, absolutely.
Go play with it. Now, Reddit's back in the news.
Oh boy, here we go again.
I saw this before the show and I'm like, oh, what is it now? Some subreddits could be paywalled.
Oh,
Reddit went public a few months back, and you know, they did the IPO. That means they got to start getting those numbers up. They got to get dollar updutes going on in their life. And you know, they got an early start last year with getting those dollar bill updutes by charging developers for API calls. And that effectively killed off third-party clients. I'm fully aware of this because I had to patch my own APK into my Reddit app. And if you're on Android or iOS, you got to use the official app. Why? Because they can shove those ads down in your face. Then they signed a deal with Googs. Talked about that on a show last week. To sell your data for AI training. They got exclusive rights. And on top of that, they also blocked all the search engines. They did everything but Google from crawling Reddit. So if you do a Google search on Bing, you do a Google search on DuckDuckGo. Site Reddit, you get the shrug emoji or whatever the old stuff. You know, the new stuff's not going to be showing up. And you can hate Reddit all you want. It's been the internet's forum for almost 20 years. That's where a lot of data is kept. And it's kind of a dangerous thing. That's why Google wrote that big check. And they're like, we want some of that. But the new bright idea to monetize Reddit was spoken into being by the CEO during an earnings call. And that's paywalled subreddits. To quote, new types of subreddits that can be built that may have exclusive content or private areas. Now, outside of the obvious stuff, we all know what I'm talking about. But the other side, pay to use. You're going to do a Google search and you're like, okay, because you're on Google. You got to be on Google, right? And you do the site and you're like, oh, look, there's the answer for the question that I have. It's right there in like the little snippet. You click on it and it's like $5.99 a month to access. Welcome to our brave new world. There's no alternative to Reddit right now. And nobody bring up Lemmy. Sorry, just don't waste time. I'm talking for average users, for regular people. You know, some of you are like, Lemmy. I'm like, I get it. I use Lemmy. Regular person doesn't. And they're not going to take regular person. Try to take, I don't want to use the word normie, but it's try to get that person on Mastodon.
Mm-hmm.
Man, 1,000-yard stares. I'm like, I don't understand why the thing does the stuff and what am I doing? So we need an alternative to Reddit. My solution is let's go back, maybe not go back, but like use bulletin board systems. For the love of Flying Spaghetti Monster, don't start throwing everything into Discord or Matrix or anything. I don't care if it's self-hosted. Chat rooms. I said this about IRC. IRC goes into this too. Don't do tech support in IRC either. Unless you really like answering the same questions over and over and over and over and over again. It always makes me very sad when I see stuff like this because it's such a great information source.
Yeah.
And there are so many fantastic communities on Reddit. I've learned so much from so many places. And if they implement this is... I don't know. And the reason I say I don't know is because of the X factor of there's no Reddit too.
Mm-hmm.
That doesn't exist.
That's scary, actually.
When Dig imploded, Reddit was in the right place at the right time.
Yeah.
You know, but right before that, Reddit was a place for people who couldn't figure out how to use 4chan. That's all it was. It was a different place, kids. And then that user base flipped over. You know, same thing with like when MySpace, for whatever, imploded. Facebook just happened to be there and they went public and things happen. They happen abruptly and they happen quick. And I'll say what I said last week. Go put your questions and your thoughts and ideas in other places. I'm not, you know, pretend you're a hipster and start using forums. I'm not going to tell you to use IRC again. But yeah, this is dark times. This is dark times.
It is. The whole time I was reading this, Ben, I was thinking, okay, so are we going to have different tiers with ads and without ads? like what Netflix and all the streaming services are.
They already have that for Reddit, right? Go on.
They do, actually, yeah.
Another thing that was on the table,
yeah,
was per post. Like, oh, if you want to get this post or whatever, you got a, you know, one-time fee, and I don't know, man. I don't know. We'll see how it plays out. If they go forward with something like this, I don't see. Get your popcorn ready. That's all.
Yeah,
I'll say.
Definitely.
Let's talk about Cyberdores.
Yeah, something happy. So this is just really the coolest Raspberry Pi Cyberdeck I have ever seen. And it even has a large rotary scroll wheel on the side to navigate your social media feeds, such as Mastodon, etc. And not just one, but two displays. And it is called the Cyberdore 2064, which was inspired by the cyberpunk genre with a Commodore 64 aesthetic and created by Tommy Lukanen, who has created other really cool Cyberdecks as well before this one. But this one, the Cyberdore 2064, he built to hang out on the couch, play some Commodore 64 games, and do a little bit of scrolling on the internet. And it's just, you know, it's just so beautifully designed. It's one of the best designed Cyberdecks I have ever seen. And there's, you know, a lot of cool devices went into building the Cyberdore 2064, which you can build yourself, including a Raspberry Pi Zero, a 3D printed case, which is available on printables.com as STL files, a small keyboard, which is Bluetooth, and it's available at AliExpress, a 3.5 LCD display, a small OLED display, and a Raspberry Pi Pico for actually running the mini OLED display to the right of the handle, and the scroll for scroll wheel control. So it uses two Raspberry Pis. You get double the love on the Raspberry Pi.
It's always fun to see stuff like that. Yeah, it could definitely do with a little bit of organization. I mean, that's good. Yeah. That looks safe. But like when you crack open something like that, and you're like, oh, boy, you might have a fun time tracking down a loose wire. But having a scroll wheel, I mean, it looks like a speak and spell.
So cool.
With a handle.
Yeah, it does. That's what I was thinking, too, like a white speak and spell, which are usually, speak and spells are usually red. But
it's 3D printed. You can make it red if you need that in your life.
Exactly.
It's got a little chocolate keyboard. So there you go. Ladies and gentlemen, let's call it. We almost got the time just about right. But if you like the show, you want to support it, head over to linuxgamecast.com. We got a support tab. We got Patreon. You can become a patron. You can drop in some show note ideas. Might talk about it right here on the show. Come check not only this show out, but Linux Gamecast Weekly, the biggest, the baddest, the longest runningest Linux gaming podcast in the world. If there was a record for it, we would have it. Back here on Twitch, 8 p.m. on Saturday for live. And of course, we have a YouTube channel, old school. We don't even have an ad sign, just / Linux Gamecast. Come watch it. Get the podcast at linuxgamecast.com and have a great rest of your week, everybody.
Yeah.
We gotta get out of here. Let's roll some credits.
Okay. Oh, cool. Steve has been said that the Cyberdore 2064 looks very space 1999, and he isn't wrong. Thank you to our executive producers and our advisor, Artharin, who contributed a lot to the show, as he does every week, and to our sea monsters, Truggy, Vera, Tenuta, to our Death Notes, Turnover, Ogiwan, Swine, Piper, Oil of Hope, to our lovely Chairlings, Michael, Ryan, Evandro.
Beautiful the names. People. Have a great rest of your week. Love to see you next time, and get out there and get up to something awesome.
All right.
Bye, everybody.
Love you all.